couple of nights ago, I went to CVS late at night, inebriated, which is the right way to do it. Because if you go to CVS when you're sober, you could be disappointed. You might go into a CVS and be like, where's a head of cabbage and my freshly caught cod? But when you go and you're not sober, you're like, awesome, this place sells frozen enchiladas and toothpaste.
Hey, it's the Propaganda Show with Andrew Justino.
Welcome to the Propaganda Show. Applause. I'm also the applause like sign for the show too. So I'll just sometimes say laugh and applause, and it's organic. So when I was at the CVS, I was about to leave. I had my Cool Ranch Doritos, I had my Pepto-Bismol, my vitamin D3 pills, some Oreos, and a single donut. But when I was about to leave, out of the blurred corner of my eye, I saw something beautiful. I saw this. Yeah, I'm doing prop comedy now. This is the National Enquirer, and it caught my eye because it says Meghan Markle, who is the Queen of England now, and Matt Lauer, who's famous for being on Every Mother's Television, and now he's no longer there, which is crazy because he's on the National Enquirer. So I was like, oh my God, Meghan Markle and Matt Lauer had a dressing room hookup? Did you guys hear about this? Did anyone hear about this? That's okay, because it's made up. This isn't true at all. You can search this and no one else has reported this. But what is interesting is around the same time that this was made, it just came out that last year, the top two most Googled people were Meghan Markle and Matt Lauer. So the National Enquirer was like, what if we said they Googled each other? That's gotta sell a lot of paper. But that's not true. So if you're not hip on today's print media, which is embarrassing, but I won't tell anyone, the National Enquirer is a tabloid. Mm-hmm. And tabloids are nuts because tabloids can just say whatever. I went down the rabbit hole and I went home and I was like, I need to get to the bottom of this. First I bought this, which was a problem because I thought it was gonna be like dirt cheap. I thought, like, I always heard the word like penny saver. I thought this was that. It's not. This costs $7. But I was too embarrassed after I said, can I get one of those? Like, to be like, whoa, it's $7. Never mind. So I just bought it. I was like, yeah, I got that kind of cash to spend on garbage. So I bought it. I went home, and I did my homework. I went online, and I went down a rabbit hole so you guys wouldn't have to. You're welcome. And what I discovered was the National Enquirer was founded in the 1930s, but it wasn't doing too well at first because no one wanted to read it because it was just bad news. Like, it wasn't like this. It was just, like, not actual news. It'd be like, today it's going to be warm out, and then it'd be cold. And like everyone's like, that's not even fun. There's no sex in that. So no one was buying it. But then things changed in 1952 when this guy named Generoso Pope Jr. This guy bled the colors of the Italian flags, except for white and green, so just the red part, but still, he was super Italian. And he also worked for the CIA as a psychoanalyst and was in the mafia too, which for some reason to me is kind of like being an astronaut and a pirate or something. Like, it's just like, pick one, man. But yeah, so he bought this newspaper in 1952 using mob money, but then used his skills as like a CIA, like, psycho guy to make it profitable, because what he realized was something that we all know, that people love car accidents. I know I do. I drive around all night looking for a juicy car accident so I can get my rocks off. And he figured it out first. So he's like, let's start putting juicy car accidents on these magazines. So he did that. And he was like, all right, car accident, car accident, car accident. People were like, I'm sick of car accidents. So then he found out his real moneymaker, which was moms eating children. So he started doing stuff like moms eat baby. Mom cooks, then eats baby. Mom slow roasts baby to perfection and five other ways to improve your sex life. And it was great. People loved this crap. But there was a problem. Everyone loves reading about mothers eating their babies. Fact. But it's hard to subscribe to that now, you know? Like, you don't want to every day be like, all right, give me more mom eating babies. So you don't want that delivered to your house every day, and this was a problem. You didn't have people that were actually subscribing to the newspaper. So Jenpo Joe was like, guys, I'm so smart. This is what we're going to do. We're going to sell it at, like, convenience stores. So that way, when people are, like, buying their Doritos and their Pepto-Bismol or whatever was sold in the 50s, they'll be like, I need that too. Perfect, right? End of story. You talk to the CVS's, you talk to the Walgreens's, you talk to the 7-Eleven's's, and they are like, yeah, that sounds great, except for one other problem, guys. They were like, you can't do that. Because we have moms that shop at our place. If a mom comes in here, sees mom eats baby at a newspaper, you know what she's gonna do, right? She's gonna be like, that's a great idea, I'm gonna eat my baby. And then they can't sell diapers anymore, guys. It's economics, it's a problem. So they said, you have to do something else. And he's like, no problem. What if I just start making up things about celebrities? And they're like, perfect, that sounds great. And that's how you get stuff like this. This is gonna be tough. Junior, wanna try again on this, Junior? Yeah, get in there. So this says, Elton's dog bit my child's face. And if you read the article, you find out that this person says that 8 years ago, Elton John's dog bit their child's face, and that is not why they are annoyed, says Mary, who is 39. You know what that means. She says she's annoyed because Elton John still has never called to apologize. Guys, have you heard about this? No, that's because it's not true. I Googled it, though, and I did find something out on the day that this article came out. This is true. Elton John's dog died. Come on, guys. Don't beat a dog when he's dead, is the classic saying. Come on. So that's why today's show, every comedian that's going to come up is going to talk about the National Enquirer and what it means to them. Right, guys?
Yes.
Yeah. You did that? Yeah, cool. You didn't do that? Shiv? Yeah, come on. Why do I have a team if you're not going to do it? Okay, whatever. Since he's not doing it, it's going to seem awkward if just one person doesn't do it. So, guys, I know you had a lot of material set on the National Enquirer. Can you just skip over and just do some jokes about, like, I don't know, whatever is making you anxious right now instead? Does that work? That sound good? Okay. So why don't we do that then? Okay. So your first performer is going to come on the stage, and he's a really nice guy. He shares the last name with one of my top 20 favorite actors of the 80s. Ladies and gentlemen, Jeremiah Broderick.
Guys, I'm angry at Hershey's. Guys, no Hershey's. Largest producer of candy bars. The candy industrial complex, as I call them. And you guys know what they make? They make chocolate. The same thing that is in every other candy bar. No creativity. And for years, this was their only thing. They just did chocolate. They were just pumping it out. Till one day, there was this brave executive who stood up at a meeting, probably. And he said, you know what, I've had enough. Too much chocolate, we gotta switch it up. His boss was like, listen, we're way ahead of you. We're gonna hit them with the second ingredient. We're gonna throw nuts in there. And he was like, all right, everyone loves peanuts. Seems like a no-brainer. He's like, no, we're going with the almond, America's third favorite nut. All right, well, almonds, they're crunchy. Crunchy. Crush them up, get them in the bottom there, get a nice little crunch, that'll be good. No, we're going whole almond. With a razor sharp tip. It's gonna be like a flavorless arrowhead fell into your candy bar. All right, well, how's it gonna fit in the candy bar? Because that seems like it would just be like a lumpy, asymmetrical piece of chocolate. Yes. Because that's what the people want. Lumpy, asymmetrical chocolates. But can you imagine what we could achieve if Big Candy really focused and, like, put some creativity? You know, we could have a double-sided Twix in this country. Yeah, caramel on two sides. And I know what you're thinking. thinking caramel on two sides, it's not going to be a flat side for me to put it down. You're not going to put it down. That's the answer. You're going to eat that whole bad boy in one sitting. I looked up I got two facts for you. I looked them both up. They're true. Fact number one is that last year in the United States, over 4,000 people were hit by trains. Fact number two is that over 99% of the earth is covered in not train tracks. That's true. I tend to stand there. But since this is apparently a public safety concern, what I've done is I've come up with a guide for how you can avoid being hit by trains. And I want you to run through this with me. It's for safety. Step one, gotta ask yourself a really simple question. Am I currently standing between two giant metal tracks? Step two, she got to listen for a very particular noise. Now it goes something like this. It goes, a chugga-chugga, chugga-chugga, choo-choo. Now, if the answer to both one and two is yes, you're just going to want to take one medium to large size step. That's all you got to do. I got a little bit of a history lesson for you. Most people don't know this, but in 1986, the FDA commissioned what was really the most important poll of dentists this nation's ever seen. And you've probably heard it quoted in Trident ads or toothbrush ads. Gets quoted a lot, and it was a real turning point for an entire industry. So I thought it would be a treat if I recited the entire thing tonight. Here it goes. 4 out of 5 dentists recommend Trident gum. 4 out of 5 dentists recommend a Colgate brand electric toothbrush. 4 out of 5 dentists recommend checking on that fifth dentist already. These kind of seem like no-brainers. 1 out of 5 dentists recommends letting him be an individual for once in his life. 4 out of 5 dentists recommend you take this seriously, Doug. Doug, you always do this. This right here, Doug, is why no one sits with you at lunch. 2 out of 5 dentists recommend we leave Doug alone. You know, he's a good guy and he's really trying his best. 2 out of 5 dentists, but like a different 2 out of 5 dentists than the 2 out of 5 dentists that were just talking, recommend that we're gonna go make out in the other room because we've been lovers this whole time. 3 out of 5 dentists recommend gasping, because this is shocking news. 1 out of 1 FDA administrators recommends you all get your shit together and focus, because if you can't, I got 5 orthodontists outside who will. 4 out of 5 dentists recommend daily flossing. 4 out of 5 dentists recommend, really, Doug? Was that you again? Doug, this right here is why your wife left. 1 out of 5 dentists recommends, I've had enough of this, in parentheses, footsteps. 4 out of 5 dentists recommends, Doug, where'd you get that knife? 3 out of 4 dentists recommends, oh my God, he's killing him. Doug is killing him, send help. And I think it's weird they don't read the whole thing in the Trident ads. So I think it ends a lot of context. Thank you, guys.
Another round of applause for Jeremiah. We can also get some applause for Jimmy B over on his Casio. He's got the short chair today. Jeremiah.
Hi.
Welcome to my dojo.
Thank you for having me.
What's your favorite chocolate bar?
Kit Kat?
What's the Kit Kat?
Nobody knows.
Oh.
That's kind of why I like it. It's a little bit of a mystery.
All right. Do you like to lie? Like, in real life, like, all the time, like, when talking to friends, family, loved ones.
No, but most of that was a lie.
Yeah, that's why I asked, because I...
That's true.
Like, most of comedy usually is a lie.
I did look up that train fact.
You did?
I did Google that.
Oh, nice. Good for you.
So
now I'm going to ask you one more question, but I'd like it to be longer. So that last bit with Doug and the dentist?
Yes.
That goes on for a while.
It does.
Did you notice that?
There's a longer version of it.
There's a longer version too? Was it because you're low on time today that you kind of, or are you workshopping it?
I'm shrinking it down. It got a little long.
Because that's what my question is. Like, did it start in its longest version, or was it shorter for a while? Like, because that's the kind of joke that you have to keep saying, like, how much momentum can I keep, right?
Yeah. It started around 2 minutes. It grew to about 4 minutes. Now it's about a 3-minute joke.
Ah, so it's like, you know, that nice sweet spot in the middle. How many times do you think you've done that joke? There's no right answer to this. I just like, I like knowing like when people are working on the bit, what they're doing.
30?
30. That's a nice round.
Between number. Like open mics.
Was this your 30th time?
I have not been.
Guys, round of applause for Jeremiah. 30th time talking about the dentist and Doug. That's so great. You get a whole pack of candles. That's my last pack though, so please don't waste them. So now my last question, our interview's a little short, is do you have anything you want to plug? Like, do you have a website, a blog, a Vimeo account?
I do not. I have a few dates coming up.
Dates, like, with a significant other?
With, like, audiences.
Oh, okay.
And, like, a show.
So your mom must be disappointed about that.
Yeah, a little bit. Yeah.
But that's still cool. Do you want to say them?
Sure. On BU's Funniest.
Oh, yeah, that's coming up.
I'm at the Riot Theater March 15th.
Wow, that sounds great, because the word riot is, like, a really strong word.
Also, the word theater makes it
sound
official.
Theater.
I like the word theater.
I like that word.
And I'm a finalist in the A Brews Comedy Contest on March 25th.
Oh, really awesome.
Yeah.
So, thank you very much, Jeremiah.
Thanks for having me.
Our next comedian who's about to perform, I believe, is also performing in the upcoming BU's Funniest, right? So, please put your hands together for the very funny Shiv Patel.
So guys, I'm 22, you know, which means I have to start talking to girls. You know, because that's just something you need to do in order to get with one. You know, but it's tough talking to girls because of the fear of rejection. You know, for example, I asked this girl out the other day, and she was like, yeah. And I was like, really? And she was like, no. Like, why did you do that? That's so sadist. You know, you could have just said no the first time. You know, and it's tough. I got mad at her, not to a point where I wish her a lot of malice in her life, but just to a point where I wish her a lot of minor inconveniences throughout the rest of her life. You know? Like, I hope, like, the next time she's on the sidewalk, she gets stuck behind a slow walker. You know? I think that could really slow her progress. You know? Or I hope that the next time she takes a shower, her towel's still wet from the last shower. You know? I think that could be diabolical. You know? Or I hope that the next time someone waves at her, that person's actually waving to the person in back of her. You know? I think that could really ruin everything. But it is tough. I asked this other girl out another day. They're the same day, because I'm a playa. No, I'm not a playa. It was another day, and she said no, which I have no idea why. You know, I mean, I even wrote, I love you, in the email subject line. You know, I thought that was something unique, something other guys didn't do. For example, miss, have you ever been email asked out before?
No.
No, exactly. I wanted to be that one guy, you know, who slid into her Yahoo. You know, Yahoo Mail, nothing else. Her Outlook, Microsoft Outlook. I thought that could be unique. But it's tough. I guess in order to get with the girl, people say you need a job. You know, so I was on that 9-to-5 grind, you know, doing some white collar work, you know, which I now understand why they call it white collar work. You know, number one, because everybody's white in the office. You know, it's just so many white people. I don't know if you've been in an office. There's just so many white people. I mean, I'm brown, so there's one, you know, but it's like I'm facing like an army in there, you know. And another thing with the 9-to-5 grind is that I've started to feel like a dad, you know, because I go to work with dads, I work with dads, and then I come back home from work with dads. So naturally, by osmosis, I'm going to start to feel like a dad, you know. It's almost like every time I enter the house, I just think to myself, daddy's home, you know. Time to burp the little babies, you know, time to burgeon my beer belly. And time to eat that pre-made meal for my wife, you know, which is completely irrational because I don't have kids yet, you know, because I'm still a virgin, you know. And let me tell you, being a virgin is the best feeling in the world. Don't let people tell you otherwise. And I have a reason, too. You know, I'm a virgin by choice, in part because my name, Shiv, ends in HIV. You know, so I think that's a bad omen for the future. I don't want to give it to anybody. You know, not that I have it. I don't have it. You know, I don't have it currently, but I could get it, you know, and I could, and everybody could get it, technically speaking, but I don't have it right now is what I'm saying to you guys. And the tough part is that it'll always be in my name, you know, so it'll always be in my license, which is always in my pocket, you know, so no matter where I go, I'll always have HIV in my pants. You know, and that's very unsettling. You laugh. That's very unsettling. You know, it's just not an attractive trait, you know. But no, I am a virgin. And I like it. You know, like one day I want to be on the Mount Rushmore of virginity, you know, alongside Steve Carell and Steve Urkel. You know, it'd be Steve, Sheev, Steve. You know, just like nice alliteration right there. But it is tough. I mean, talking to girls is tough. Sometimes I need, like, preset pickup lines. I've been working on one lately. For example, Miss, you look like you could use a little more chivalry in your life. Get it? Because my name's Shiv. Some of you cringe. That's the response I wanted. I'll explain it to the girl when I actually say it to her. But yeah, being a virgin is a beautiful thing, you know, because the majority of people are not virgins, you know. The majority of people have had sex, used protection, whatever you did, you've done the dirty deed, you know? So don't play innocent on me, I know exactly what you've done, you know? So bringing it back to being a virgin, that means that we're a part of a select few, among the chosen ones, you know? And I don't think I'm gonna meet my future wife by just having sex the first time. I think we're gonna have to have a couple of conversations. You know, like I don't think I'm gonna meet my wife one night at a bar called Tits at 2 a.m. in the morning, you know, and what would I tell my son? You know, like, yeah, Jimmy, me and your mommy met at a bar called Tits at 2 a.m. in the morning, you know, and mommy was very, very drunk, which made it very easy for daddy to swoop in like a predator and bring her home. Like, that's not hot, you know, like, that's not, if I told that to my son, he'd be like, Dad, you're a bad person, you know, you're a very bad person. Yeah, that's all I wanted to do. Thank you guys so much for listening to me.
Yeah, another round of applause for Shiv. All right, Shiv, I have a question for you.
Go ahead.
Do you have a lot of emails right now? Like, do you have a lot of unread emails?
Yes, I think they're like 5,000.
5,000. I'm up there too. Yeah. I don't know how I feel about people who have their emails together.
Yeah.
That makes me uncomfortable.
It does. That. Like, because you can't get all of them.
Yeah.
There's so much.
How could you get all the emails? Were you reading them as they come in?
Yeah, nobody reads
them. They build up too much.
And there's junk ones.
It's mostly junk ones. Yeah. Wow. All right, thank you. You stay. My next question is, do you think, in your opinion, this is like a question that I think every everyone's cousin asks this question, everyone's cousin that finds out like you're doing comedy, they're like, oh, are you doing that so you can be popular? Like, are you doing that to meet ladies, guys, or pals?
Yeah.
And I always like what people feel like they have to say to their cousin is usually different than what they actually think.
Yeah.
I know for me, because of my relationship to my cousins.
Mm-hmm.
Personal, oh, yeah. Okay. You're my cousin. Which I forgot to mention. That was so rude, I forgot. Oh my god, it's gonna be so awkward at our Sunday dinners.
Yeah.
Our whole family's there. But yeah, no, you have to kind of be like, nah, you know, you have to be cool, you have to...
Right.
So do you think doing comedy is a good way to become cool, in your personal opinion?
I do this just to get girls.
Oh, okay, you do.
Yeah. I think and virginity bit really gets...
How long have you been doing comedy now?
Is that like 3 years?
3 years? And it's working?
On and off. Yeah, a little bit lately.
Oh.
Yeah, it's coming close. Yeah,
this is a family. Can you... That is disgusting.
No, I say no. I say no.
Your actual answer? No, I'm not cousining you.
Because I'm getting that age where they'll be like, you can have access if you want. And I'm like,
what?
It's people like doing the dirty deed, you know, in general.
Yeah.
Generally speaking.
You can have access if you want.
Right. And I'm just like.
It's a cable company?
But I have to say no, because of the comedy. I have to protect the band, you know?
Yeah, you can't be happy to comedy.
Right, exactly.
Yeah. All right. Last question. Then you're getting off my stage, and I'm going to wash it down. So you do a bit where you imply, or at least imply people may think you have HIV. And I think it's no surprise that people are uncomfortable with the concept of you having HIV.
Right.
Do you like doing like the kind of comedy that makes people like, because I think everyone does some jokes like that, but like you definitely do some like where it's like cringe until they laugh.
Yeah.
Do you like doing that?
Yeah, I like making people feel uncomfortable.
Yeah.
I used to have a terrorist bit. And like I'd say like I had bombs like with me.
Oh.
And like I
that
just
that must that was, have plagued.
Oh, yeah. Some
people love to die.
They laughed.
They did.
At it. I said it was a joke at the end of it, but like they were cringing up until then.
Yeah.
But I had to take it out, like for most places. Like it's not.
Did anyone ever say like don't do that here?
Yeah.
That's sick. That's sick, dude.
That's sick. Alright.
No, wait, do you have anything you need to plug?
The BU's funniest thing.
Yeah.
Wednesday. Other than that, maybe I'll go bowling on Friday if anyone wants to join.
Catch Shiv bowling on Friday if anyone wants to join. The alley will appear here. Other than that, thank you for being on the show.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Alright. Mm-hmm. Ooh, I like this. That's good. Did you just learn to do that?
Yeah, I just tried it out.
All right, good for Jimmy. And good for us, right, guys? So, come on. I was just starting to like you. All right. Guys, our next performer is very funny, and you can find her, like, I think I run into you a lot. Whenever I actually get myself out of my cloak of bed sheets and depression and go outside, I'm like, oh, look, Pam's at this thing, because she's make sure to be everywhere, and she's a very funny person, and you're about to see her here. So please put your hands together for Pamela Ross.
Nice. We got some calypso going on. I like that. That reminds me of Maya Angelou. She used to be a calypso artist and a sex worker. How are you guys? Awesome. I don't know if this mic is on. I'm going to hold it right underneath my mouth so my germs get all over it. That's what I like to do. I am a lady. Hold your applause. I hate it. No more awards. I'm running out of shelf space. Stop. I love women's magazines because they're so profoundly sexist and condescending towards men, which I didn't know until I gave them more of like a deep dive. But if you read like any Cosmo passage about like sex or dudes, it's never like, hey, you can treat your male partner like he's a three-dimensional human. It's always like, he's a man. Trick him. trick him with your butthole. You know, and I don't appreciate that advice because I think in a relationship, like, it's important to retain anal mystique. Because it's 2018, you know, it's like I'm expected to be like a stepmom in sexual scenarios. Like, I need to keep something for myself for like my future second husband, you know? I also love those articles that are like, what's your body type? What's your body type? Like, it's like a threat. Like, why is every headline I read in a women's magazine sounds vaguely menacing? But I do love those quizzes because if you take them, every single answer, except like perfectly fuckable, like hourglass, is like, oh, you're garbage can shaped. Whoa. Dress it up with a lid, ladies, because you're trash. jazz hands. It's like, why? I don't know. It's just hard to have your confidence devastated by Teen Vogue. You know, when you've clearly like aged out of the readership already. It's hard. It's like being slut shamed by someone who stars in a Disney show. You know, you're like, this shouldn't even be for me. Like, I'm allowed to be like a little fat now. Like, I don't know. I've earned that right. I'm a 27-year-old. Goddammit. I've seen some nonsense. It's hard. Yeah, you transition from your early to mid-20s. It's in this day and age when people are like delaying, I think justifiably like delaying marriage and parenthood, like the transition isn't so difficult, but there are small changes. You know, like I'm bisexual, so like in my early 20s, my heterosexual couple friends would like ask me to have threesomes with them. I'd be like, no. And now, my later 20s, they ask me to have threesomes with them while their adopted dog watches in the corner. And I'm like, you have a dog? I'm coming over. Get ready. Get a strap on the pooch. No, that takes it too far. I just wanted to say strap on. Thank you for letting me riff at you. It means a lot. I am a bisexual woman, and I don't, like, I'm on Tinder, but only meet women. But there are, of course, couples on there with profiles. They're looking for a unicorn. They call me unicorn, bisexual woman who sleep with both of them. I'm not opposed to threesomes on principle. Like, I've had them. I went to high school. You know, like, we were all 17 and visiting a friend at college once, you know? But I don't, at this moment in time, I refuse to give a man that kind of experience, like sex with two women. And it's not because I don't want to. And it's not for personal reasons. It's for political ones. It's that at this moment in time, in the post-Trump era, I don't think any straight man deserves that. Sorry, I won't play a role in giving a man that kind of joy. Not right now, not right now. What I think we need to do, and if this is the only reason you vote, I think that's perfectly acceptable. We need to effect social change to get my unicorn pussy back on the Tinder market. Like, I need to see some progress. I need to see some progress with the midterms. We need to get out and vote, get more progressive candidates in office, you know? Decriminalize sex work, and I'll think about it, you know? I'll consider it. I've had my period for 3 weeks. I don't know why. Just want to be honest with you. I should be concerned. I'm just like, nice. I love how my body continuously reminds me, no responsibilities, you know? It's good. My last partner, this is a real true embarrassing thing about me. He was a virgin, okay? He was a virgin at 23. Sorry, guy. I just didn't know why, like, I couldn't figure it out because he's, like, hot, so I was confused. And then I found out, not that you aren't him, but this guy kind of looks like a Disney prince, you know? And he's, like, tall and white. It's not that I believe in like Eurocentric beauty standards. It's that like I'm only a woman, you know, like I see a tall white guy and I want to climb him like a tree. It's just like it's your body being like, trick that one, you know, just clamp down on him and trick him into loving you and then have his stupid babies, you know. So anyway, I was dating this guy and he was Christian, but I fixed it. It was easy. Way too easy. He could not wait to give up that personal relationship with Jesus Christ just for some action, you know, which I get. And it was fun because, like, in addition, I started sleeping with him, like, right after the election. He grew up evangelical. He's a white guy. So in addition to getting laid, like, I got to walk around. Like, I was doing important liberal activism in the wake of the election. Like, how are you resisting? Oh, you donated to the ACLU? Adorable. What am I doing? Nothing. I just... I siphoned a man's faith in God out of his body, right? Just with my body. It's a vessel of secular culture, and the Kegels are working, so clearly. I was like, you know what? After my last relationship with a man ended, I was like, if I'm ever going to date a guy seriously in the future, like, I need criteria that's a little more rigorous than just, like, doesn't hit me and is here, you know? So I was like, maybe develop more criteria, like, you're 26, like, get it together. You don't want to end up like Rory Gilmore, you know? So I was like, okay. Do you watch Gilmore Girls?
I know enough about it.
Okay.
Sorry.
You were so close. But I have criteria, and the criteria that I developed was no nerds, which for me is just defined in, like, just too many video, like, if you are more transfixed by your video game console than my vulva, like, that's a no, right? Okay, there's that. No sad boys, which I define, like, if you're a straight white guy and, like, you're still sad for a reason I can't discern, like, stop. Like, I can't, like, stop it. Every movie is about you, like, I sleep with you, like, stop. And then the third one was no one who's never been to therapy, okay? Never been to therapy at least once. So I have been dating women. I've been dating women, and it's good. People don't always, like, believe that I'm bi, you know, but I have a way of counteracting that. I have my membership card on me at all times. You know, you gotta keep it on your person. And it's just, I can flash it at people. It's an old dirty Polaroid of me, like, knuckles deep in a woman. It's not, and people, you know, they see it and they really stop asking questions and start asking for more photos. All right, that's my time. Thank you so much.
All right, yeah. Wonderful job. Sell me on Gilmore Girls, like, really quick.
Here's the thing. The way, because it used to be on the WB, now it's the W.
Yeah.
It was marketed as just a kind of like a teen soap nonsense.
I used to confuse Gilmore Girls and that movie with Sigourney Weaver and Jennifer Love Hewitt called The Heartbreakers. I used to think that was the same.
And that's a testament to how misleading the marketing is. It makes it seem like just like this nonsense mother-daughter relationship. And that is the most important relationship in the show. It's actually kind of refreshing in a lot of ways. Mm-hmm. But it's smart, it's funny, centers women's stories, and you should watch it.
I just watched Marvelous Mrs. Maisel, and I love that. Yeah. So then I was like, ugh, maybe I have to watch Gilmore Girls now. Which is not because I didn't want to watch Gilmore Girls, but it's like I'd rather just go to bed forever than watch anything else, you know?
Well, it's seven seasons plus the Netflix. It's a lot of TV.
That makes me sleepy. But let's talk about not Gilmore Girls. Okay with that? You talked about like women's magazines a bit, mm-hmm. and like how, like, you know, it's like transit. Do you, just wondering, not like I've done this recently, but do you do like research like for the comedy bit, like where you're like, I'm gonna read some extra Cosmo articles, like stuff that you're not even interested in, just to be like, I want to see what's out there.
You know, I do read. I like to just like scan the Cosmo website, but it's less for my stand up and more for like the satire, right? Because there's like.
Oh, right.
Or doctors and, like, pink canoe and stuff like that.
Yeah.
So you need to keep your finger on
the pulse. To know, like, what the original kind of is before you can, like, parody it.
What are you making fun? Yeah. What are you subverting?
Yeah. You can't just be like, I know Cosmo's a thing, so I'll just call mine, like, Osmo.
Sluts are garbage! I mean, to be fair,
that's most of what I'm writing on Reddit. So you've been doing comedy for a while now, and you've done it in a lot of different venues, I assume, right? What have you, like, obviously each audience is a very different kind of system. Like, even if you're doing the exact same jokes, you feel like you've done them the exact same way, you can have a completely different reaction, right?
Mm-hmm.
Does that, like, at this stage, like, how much does that keep affecting you, and how much is it still just, like, I still like certain jokes? Or, like, you know, if you have a joke that, like, 9 out of 10 rooms is still hitting, mm-hmm. does it matter that that one room, like, just didn't get it to you anymore?
No, because even if you're doing the same materials, stand-up, part of what makes it hard is, like, it's continuous yeah. negotiating the room, reading that.
I like that, negotiating.
Figuring out. Yeah, it's like negotiating the yeah. circumstances to make sure everything goes as well as possible.
Sometimes the negotiation is, like, for me at least, it's like, I'll stop talking sooner if you laugh more now.
Yeah.
And people are like, oh, okay.
It is
if
not
I laugh,
like
I'll go.
Keeping hostages.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's hostages, but they can't see the guns.
Right. The guns are my zingers.
Yeah.
They're my finger guns.
Do you have anything you want to plug?
Yeah, you can follow me on Twitter at Pam.Anderson.
It's okay. Right below your face.
PamelaAnderson.squarespace.com, and right now my show is on hiatus, but I think we're coming back like first weekend of April.
Is this the Mendoza Line?
Mendoza Line. The Dugout Cafe. Mm-hmm. Come out. It was renovated. It looks great. Come check it out. All
right,
Saturdays
awesome.
At 9.
Cool.
Thank you.
And I also want to plug again. Sorry, I don't mean to overplug. Shiv is going bowling this Friday. If you can make it, he'd really appreciate it.
You shouldn't miss it.
Yeah, so thank you. You can take
thank
a seat.
You.
Thank you. All right, guys. I'm really excited for this next segment. We're going to learn how to do some dancing, and I am excited to learn how to do anything. So this is one of those things. We're going to learn some salsa dancing, but first, we have some important messages from our sponsors, so please check those out right now. Play music, Jimmy.
Thank you. Welcome back to the Propaganda Show. We're about to do something really fun. We're going to learn some salsa dancing with Sasha Parodi. She's come all the way to this studio here, which is located, as everyone knows, on the top of Mount Everest, and it is very hard to get up here. It is quite the climb. We're all very nauseous. And we're going to learn.
Dancing.
Yeah, I'm ready for dancing. So we're going to learn some salsa dancing. Shiv and Jeremiah have joined us again to participate in this, and I think it's going to be great. I don't even know if they'll be able to hear you, which is funny.
That's why I did the wave.
Yeah, great. Sick.
So salsa is an 8-count dance. So I'm just going to demo the basic for you so that you see what it looks like, and then we're going to clap it out, and then we will try it together. Sound good?
Yes.
Okay. So this is the basic. 1, 2, 3, 5, 6, 7. So you're just walking back and forth. So if you notice, I didn't say 4 and 8 because you're going to pause on those. So 1, 2, 3, pause, 5, 6, 7, pause. So that's the idea. So first we're going to clap all together.
Okay.
Like we're in kindergarten.
Yes.
Ready? 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, pause. 5, 6, 7, pause. 1, 2, 3, pause. 5, 6, 7, pause. Feel more comfortable with the beat? A little?
Yes.
Yeah? Okay. So we're going to do the steps. So you start with your left foot forward, and then you're going to step back on your right, and then you're going to come together to the middle. Okay. And then you're going to step back on your right. 1, 2. So 1, 2, 3, pause. 5, 6, 7, pause. 1, 2, 3, pause. 5, 6, 7, pause. One more time. 1, 2, 3, pause. 5, 6, 7, pause. Yeah.
This stage is like the most rickety. Like, I keep waiting for us to just like,
extra noise for it.
We're like a foot off the ground though. I think we'll be safe no matter what.
Yeah.
Now I forgot everything though.
Okay, it's okay. We'll do it again. If you want, you can add a little shoulder shimmy.
Yeah,
shake your hips. Do add your own little
right.
version to it right. if you want. 1, 2, 3, pause. 5, 6, 7. Pause. 1, 2, 3, pause. 5, 6, 7, pause. 1, 2, 3, 5, 6, 7. Yeah, so it's kind of like you decide to walk forward and then you're like, wait.
Okay.
You step
yeah.
back.
Whoa, hold
and
on.
Then you step all backwards right. and then you're like, yeah.
I like it a lot.
Yeah. So basically, you're just indecisive the whole time.
I used to think I was good at dancing, but then I realized I never learned how to dance. I meant that like I could go to like a dance and be like, I'm drunk. So this is a new thing I'm learning. I'm mediocre at. All right, but I'm loving it. I'm having a great time. So cool. Let's keep going.
Okay, so we're gonna try it to music now. So right. First, we're gonna clap it out to the music so okay. that you're comfortable with the beat, and then I'll let you know when to go. All right, so add music, please. One, two, three, pause, five, six, seven, pause. One, two, three, pause, five, six, seven, pause. Okay, are you ready?
Yeah.
Okay. One, two, three, pause, five, six, seven, go. One, two, three, pause, five, six, seven, pause. One, two, pause, five, six, seven, pause. One, two, three, pause, five.
I can't do it. It's like the saddest moment of my life. But I'm loving it. Like, this is really great, Sasha.
Yeah, you guys are doing great. Okay, we're off the beat, so we're going to try and find it again.
Okay.
Five, six. One, two, three. Five, six, seven. One, two, three. Five, six, seven. One, two, three. Try shimmy.
I don't know if I can no. shimmy and do it.
Yeah, you guys are great. I'm even counting.
Oh, yeah, we're... I feel one, like I'm dancing two, exactly three, how someone who looked five. At me thought I would dance.
One, two, three.
Like that guy who
okay.
dances like this.
All right. Thank you. How'd that feel?
Felt great.
Yeah? Good? Y'all look great. Some things to keep in mind is you don't want to take huge steps because if yeah. the music is faster, which it usually is, you'll be like
it's
running.
It's usually faster than that?
Yes.
Okay.
And you want to keep your arms centered so that if you were dancing alone and you wanted to dance with somebody, you could come up and ask them to dance and you'd be ready to go. So that's kind of the idea, so keep your arms in the middle.
That's nice. That's really like communal. I like that.
Yeah. Yeah. Are you guys ready to do partner work?
We'll say yes. Yeah.
Okay. Right? Cool. Yeah. So who's going to be the leader in this pair?
You have danced before.
Okay, yeah.
Okay. Okay, so why don't you swap sides because I'll be the leader okay. in our pair. So leaders, you're going to hold your hands out like this, kind of like a gate. And then followers, you are going to perch.
Oh, so I do this?
Yes.
Okay.
Like this. Perfect. Okay. So before, so salsa is all about, it's a dance of communication. So really, it's just a language. So before.
I only know English, so like I'm not good at that either.
Like you're learning something new.
8 years of Spanish, I only know English.
So before we step it out, we are going to work on tension, which is kind of the connection okay. between your bodies. So what you're going to do is you're going to connect the way we just did, like this, yeah.
Okay.
And both of you are going to lean back. And then without telling each other, you're going to lean
with that, yeah,
forward.
Sorry.
Yeah, so the idea is that you're pulling on, you're using each other to lean back and forth. So don't lock your arms, just, yeah. And so it's not like, yeah, so and then pull each other forward. You kind of want to feel like seaweed. Sorry,
sorry. Seaweed.
Yeah, yep. Nice and light, yeah, but like you want to be, yeah, so.
I think I'm like off. No. You're like flowing
so
this way and I'm, okay.
Follow my lead. So yeah, I'm pulling, okay. like I'm pulling, so yeah, you want to pull as well. Okay. Lean
wait,
backwards.
Oh, wait.
Yeah,
okay.
Lean and then forward.
Okay.
Yeah.
Whoa. All right.
So I'm not technically telling you when I'm leaning back, although I just said it. So that's it. Okay.
I like that people are like scared to laugh at this or something. Like, like, oh God.
This is the weirdest.
This is more uncomfortable than the bomb jokes, I think. We're like, just blow us up.
Okay. So now we're going to step. So there's a slight caveat for you two. So you are going to be mirroring our steps. So what we just learned with the basic, we're stepping forward on our one. You're actually going to start with the second part of that. So you're going to step back with your right. And then forward with your left together, and then forward. So you're just reversing the basic. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. And it should be relatively easy because you're like, if I'm stepping forward, you would logically step back with that foot.
Oh, okay.
And then you're coming back together, and then I'm stepping back with this foot.
So you step forward.
Yes. Oh, okay. Yeah.
So I think given like 15 more hours, I can get this. Yeah.
Okay. Five, six, seven.
Oh wait, can we play music for this, or should we not?
Let's try it without.
No music. No music. Yeah. Let's do no music. We're not ready. Yay, now I'm good.
We'll do music after.
Yeah, yeah.
Five, six, seven. One, two, three. Five, six, seven. Good. One, two, three. Five, six, seven. One, two, three. Five, six, seven. One, two. Perfect. Five, six,
okay.
Seven.
We're starting to get this, guys.
Yeah, you guys look good. Five. Okay, I think we're ready for music. Yeah.
Hit it.
My hands perspire.
Five, six, seven, one, two, three. 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 Five, six, seven.
Yeah, applaud. Applaud, damn it.
Five, six, seven, one, two, three.
This is exciting, guys. You probably didn't think you were gonna learn anything today.
I thought.
Yeah,
I
you guys are doing great. You're staying on beat.
Oh yeah. I wish I knew the lyrics.
Okay. All right. I think you guys got it. All right. Good job. Give
Thank
yourselves
you.
A round of applause.
A round of applause to ourselves and from you guys, and a round of applause for Sasha for showing us the beginner's guide to salsa here. Do you still actively like do salsa in like a community group or anything like that?
Yeah, there's a really big salsa scene in Boston, so so I go to a lot of events and I dance with a training team. So we just like work on our technique and
that's
stuff.
Pretty cool.
There's Club Havana, which is like down the street, and they have really good beginner classes.
Down the street from the top of Mount Everest, where we are located.
Yeah, you know exactly where we are. Yeah. And they have really good beginner classes on Friday and Saturday nights, and also a bar. So, you know, if you want to go and dance for a little bit, but also want like a more chill environment to learn to dance in, that's a good place to start. Also, this is a little far ahead, but in the summers, there's this event called Salsa in the Park, which is free and open to the public. And it's a community event that was created to prevent violence in the streets that was happening in the areas in South Boston. And now it's just a free salsa event every Monday night. Oh. And they have great classes there. So I highly recommend that.
That is awesome.
Yeah.
All right. That sounds really good. All right, guys. Once again, another round of applause for Sasha Parodi. And a round of applause for Jeremiah Broderick, Shiv Patel, and Pamela Ross. And keep it going. Keep it going. And a round of applause for you guys for coming to the show. And for you people at home, including my dad and anyone that's looking at their television right now. If you are interested in being on the show, there's an email. We also have a website now, which I made, and it is shiny. They recently used the same exact website template on an episode of Queer Eye, which you can watch on Netflix. I don't know why I plugged it, but the point is, that means my website's pretty good, I'm thinking. So you can check that out for more information on the show. You can come watch this live because it's free. And there's also a lot of information about, I don't know, other things, including these people and stuff like that. Not like personal information. It'll just be like things that you want people to know, I think. Except for Shiv's information, that will be personal because this Friday, you can go bowling with Shiv Patel. Please be there. Thank you, guys, and have a great forever and all. All right, thank you, guys.